Revenge travel. As more and more countries open their doors to tourists, the explorer inside me just wants to get the best out of each place I visit. This time, my compass leads me back to Singapore, an explosive haven for all things grand. In this episode, we will visit some of the most luxurious hotels and restaurants, spectacular tours, and wellness spas. There is always something new to discover here in this vibrant city. So join me on my special escapade through Singapore. The world has finally opened up again, and as editor-in-chief of Metro Society, I take every opportunity to discover new places, meet new people, and explore different cultures. Join me in my journey to luxurious and meaningful experiences. This is Raul Manzano, EIC on the Move. What a delight! Upon arriving, I was brought straight to one of Singapore's most historical restaurants, the new Ubin Seafood, for a welcome lunch and quick icebreaker.
New Ubin Seafood is truly Singaporean cuisine.
There's a lot of cuisine because there are a lot of races.
Yes.
When we go to a hawker center to eat, we will sit down and order satay, which is Malay, or it can be also Chinese satay. You can order tahu goreng, which is Malay. Yes. You can order mee rebus with Malay.
And chicken rice, yes.
Yes, also ethnic Chinese.
Ethnic Chinese.
Only in Singapore.
Yeah. And this restaurant was named after an island up north, right?
Yes. And the name Ubin in Malay is actually means granite. All the foundations of all the old buildings here, the granite came from that island.
From the Palau Ubin.
Yes. Yeah. This dish is from New Ubin Seafood.
So it's so crispy.
Yes. Yeah. So even if you don't like brinjal, this would be something you like.
With an array of dishes, New Ubin specializes in harmonizing a majority of Chinese, Malay, and Indian cuisine. As a well-known seafood restaurant, New Ubin knows they should also serve more than just the bounties of the sea. So, why steak in a seafood restaurant?
Ah, good question.
Yeah.
Reason being that we are not the only seafood restaurant.
Yes.
But we are only seafood restaurant to serve you very good beef.
Yeah. So you have to be above the rest,
of
right?
Of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
Cannot just be seafood. You have to serve the best. Yeah.
Correct.
Beef.
So now we have US ribeye choice.
That's the wedges. Magic word, ribeye. Okay.
Smoked sea salt.
Okay.
Then Dijon mustard and of course ketchup.
Ketchup for the potato.
And that is the most important.
Yeah.
Heart attack fried rice. Yeah.
And now we're going to end with something sweet.
Yes.
This is the three kinds of ice cream that you make at the restaurant.
Yes, correct. Salted caramel, coconut ice cream, as well as vanilla.
Then the famous kaya toast.
Yes, which is a breakfast dish in Singapore.
Yes.
Deep fried mantou, bread with filling of kaya.
Mr. Pang, I think you overfed me. I am so happy. There's so much food, but wow, it was worth sitting here with you, talking about real Singaporean cuisine.
Yes.
And we're ending it on a very nice, sweet note.
Okay. Please, try.
My lunch at New Ubin Seafood was a pleasant surprise. So for anyone who wants to experience authentic Singaporean kampong-style food, come pay a visit to New Ubin Seafood, truly Singaporean cuisine. A heritage hideaway steeped in timeless romance, the Barracks Hotel provides a historical view of Singapore's maritime past. This establishment had undergone several meticulous renovations, blending modern with the old world charm. We are now here at the Barracks Hotel in Sentosa Island. This was once a British artillery outpost.
Hi Raul, Welcome to the Barracks Hotel.
Hi, Christine. Thank you so much for having us here. I love the facade of the building. Was this original?
Yes, this is original. This building was built in 1904. This used to be the original military outpost itself.
When did you convert it into a hotel?
So we started the conversion in 2018.
Okay.
We opened in December 2019.
Okay.
And the facade, the one that you see over here, we have conserved it.
Yes.
But what you actually need to see is what is right behind the hotel itself.
Because it's a different story.
It's totally different.
Okay, let's go take a look.
Sure, this way.
So you're right, this is totally different from the outside.
Yes, it's totally different because Barracks is built for you to be connected to the city, and yet the minute you enter the premises, you will totally disconnect. This room is called the living room.
Okay.
Like being a home for you.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
This is the living room where you can rest and you can relax and can have your evening cocktail. Come, let me show you that.
Okay.
This way. Here you are at my favorite place on this Barracks Hotel itself.
Okay, yeah.
This is the place where I come in the morning for breakfast, in the afternoon for an afternoon tea, and in the evening when I really want to unwind, I have a beautiful bar over here for
you. That's the magic word for me, the
bar. Yes, the bar. But we served up plates of canapes for you to go with your bar.
Okay.
The refreshment is also available for you to bring to the room itself.
Okay, my goodness. Perfect. Yes.
How about we get a glass of wine? And then I can show you the room.
Perfect suggestion.
Good job.
Okay. Cheers.
And this way.
Okay. So Christine, it's like walking through history here along this old part of the building.
Yes. So as part of our conservation exercise, we actually have retained some of the old features of the building itself. For example, the doors, this louvre windows that you have over here, these are all since 1904 days.
So these are
Wow. And because we also wanted to keep an element of history itself, what we have gotten is we have also put up a little bit of artifacts, photos of the old days itself.
Yeah.
So you can feel like you're walking down the entire museum gallery
You
do. Yeah, so one of the more interesting pieces that he's left since 1904 is this little shoehorn that is over there.
Yes.
They used that to polish the shoes when they were in the past.
Oh my god.
Just to add a little bit more interest into the room itself, you will notice that some of the rooms actually have names right on the door of the suites.
The Maltby suite.
Yeah, so these are all named after General of War itself.
Okay.
The minute you walk into the suite, you actually see the artifact that is related to the general.
All the wine openers here.
Yes, so that's Quartz nice for us.
Yes, exactly. Cheers.
And here we are. We're going to reach your room itself.
Yes.
So this room is the garden suite. There are only two units of it over there. Super exclusive for two person itself.
Okay, so this is the
right over here.
Popham suite.
Yes. Here you are to your suite.
An amazing room. You've got the gentleman's bar, you've got this beautiful table here.
Yeah, so actually when we designed the barracks itself, we have kept in mind that this is a heritage building.
Yes.
So we want to combine some of the old charm, but yet you need all your modern refinements around here. So the old charm, you'll be talking about this strong marble, the dark woods, the brass, the leather that you see around here itself. And the interesting cabinet was designed after a chest in the past.
Okay.
But your modern day refinement, what you find inside there, you actually find your Nespresso machine for a beautiful cup of coffee in the morning. So what we have done with the bedroom is you have all your modern comforts.
Yes.
So if you have a phone and then you want to play your favorite music, we have a beautiful Marshall charger over there. Beautiful cement mattress for you to sleep on with you and your partner. And more importantly, to keep the old world charm, we actually have nice frame-up photos of some of the olden day photos that you have over in Barracks.
I love the floor lamp. I mean, it's beautiful.
Yes. So this is a beautiful design element that you'll find in every single Barracks room itself.
How many rooms do you have here?
So we have 40 rooms.
Well, that's why it's nice and exclusive.
It's nice and exclusive.
And also we're in this beautiful bathroom, which is very classic and elegant, but not modern touches, right?
Yes. So what we have added in is we have added in this huge, nice round tub over here, which you don't typically see in the normal hotel rooms itself. Yes. And we kept it round because this is meant to be for a couple, right?
Couple,
so they fit them very nicely in the tub.
Snugly.
Snugly, yes. But if you come with your family, the kid also like the tub.
Yeah, of course, yes.
They get their rubber little doggy,
yes.
And then they will play in the tub itself. More importantly, on top of all these things, we also have modern comforts.
Yes.
So all the shower rooms comes perfectly endowed with rain showers.
Rain showers, yes.
And every toilet itself comes with a very nice automated bidet itself.
Yes, exactly.
So this is something that you don't find in most of the hotels.
Yes, yeah. And I like what I like about it, it has two vanities. Yeah.
Yes.
This leads also to the living room now.
Yes, this way.
Let's try sitting down in the living room.
Sure, enjoy the leather seats.
Leather seats, yes.
Yes. So this is actually one of the two, very unique, and the unique part is the garden.
Okay.
What do I mean by the garden? You take a look right outside.
That's the pool.
So,
yeah.
No, that's not only the pool.
And
when you walk outside, you come into your private patio.
Okay.
That is huge enough for you to have a private dining for two under the stars. And right outside at the pool patio, this is like a semi-private jacuzzi for yourself.
Okay.
Where you can enjoy.
Yes.
And a very private part of the entire length of pool for barracks itself, which you can have it exclusively to yourself if you stay in this room. Very, very private.
Christine, thank you so much for taking me around this historic and amazing hotel. I'm just so impressed at the way you kept the heritage, but updated it with all the amenities of a modern hotel. This definitely will be one of the hotels I'll stay in when I'm back in Singapore.
Thank you, Raul, for taking your time to come here. So do let me know when you are coming back and you want to stay with us.
Yeah.
We'll book you into this hotel itself.
Thank you again.
You're welcome.
To those who wish to spend their vacation at the Barracks Hotel in Sentosa, you're in for a treat. Visit the Oasia Spa. Tranquility and peace merge as this highly rated spa has an extensive list of treatments. After a long day of travel, a spa like this is worth all the wait.
Good morning, Mr. Raul. Welcome to Oasia Spa Sentosa.
Thank you so much for having us here at Oasia.
It's the first spa destination managed by Far East Hospitality.
Okay.
Yeah. And we launched together with Oasia Resort Sentosa in September 2021.
Yeah.
We are also the first spa in Southeast Asia and Oceania who partner with the Kotoshina skincare products, which is an organic brand from Kyoto, Japan.
So Sabrina, what treatment am I having today? Okay.
Mr. Rao, we are very happy to have you enjoy the 60 minutes Oasia signature massage.
Okay, I'm looking forward to that.
Thank you very much. Okay, this way please.
Thank you. Way to end the day. Rewarding yourself with a massage like this makes the hours of waiting and travel worth every penny. If you want to feel revitalized after a long day, you must try Oasia's signature massage. Another exciting part when traveling is discovering new trails and sites, and Singapore has all the perfect spots just for that. There are a total of 8 trails here, each having some very elegantly designed pedestrian bridges. but the one that caught my attention was the Henderson Waves. I take time out from my busy schedule to run. It gets my heart going and it gives me the energy I need to go through the day. It's still dark. I'm here at Henderson Waves and I decided to do my run today outdoors. It's cooler and there are no people around here. I'm winding down my 20-kilometer run. I've crossed the highest pedestrian bridge in Singapore. I've run through a wooded area, and now it's morning. I'm going to finish my run. Fort Canning Park is an iconic hilltop landmark which has witnessed many of Singapore's historical milestones. It served as the headquarters for the Far East Command Center and British Army Barracks during World War II. I'm going to cool down here after my 20-kilometer run. For a more traditional perspective, Fort Canning Park offers a trail that is full of culture and heritage. The park was originally known as Bukit Larangan, or Forbidden Hill, in Malay. It's no wonder that this place is full of attractions from ancient artifacts for history buffs to outdoor lawns for concerts and, of course, greenery for nature lovers. Many of the city's attractions are only a car ride away. But the thrills of the sea is another great destination that shouldn't be missed here in Singapore. Here at the Sentosa Cove, the ONE15 Charters Luxury Yachting offers more than a private cruise for hire. They can also teach you the ropes of operating a vessel with the help of veteran captains and crew members. John, thank you so much for having us on this beautiful boat. Can you explain to me what ONE15 Charters is?
Sure. Well, thank you for having me.
Yes.
So for us, ONE15 Charters Luxury Yachting, this is our charter arm of 1°50 Marina Sentosa Cove. Mm-hmm. So within this charter arm, we've got 44 boats,
yes,
or yachts. Mm-hmm. So the range is huge. So the range, we go from a 30-footer fishing boat all the way to super yachts at 116 feet.
Wow, that's big. How many berths do you have here at 1:15?
Within 1:15, we've got 270 berths.
Oh, that's a lot, huh?
Yes.
And then you can also accommodate the super yachts.
So for us is, we recently went through a renovation. We spent $7 million to reconfigure the whole marina because we saw that the size of yachts are increasing.
Yeah.
So what we did was we increased the size of yachts from 120 feet, the biggest one before, and now it's 220. So that was a big jump for us. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When a client charters a boat, what activities can they do?
Sure, there are a few things. From going from the actual charter itself, so you can, depending on what you want to do, you purposely pick the different kind of yachts, which our team can advise on. If you just want to have a small fishing trip, you know, with a few friends, few beers, yes, we can recommend a 30, 40 footer, go out to Lazarus or beyond at Hantu Islands and do some fishing there.
Yeah.
Or if you want to do corporate events, then it gets a bit more fun. We can hire a much larger yacht, like a 60, 70 catamaran. Then we can go out and with a corporate group with around 50 people.
Okay.
Or if you're into super private charters, then you've got the super yachts that are on the other side.
On the other side.
So from up to 116 feet.
Yeah.
So we have as little as two people as a couple go on these charters. I mean, having a private anniversary dinner, or wedding, engagements, and all those.
So you even handle getting the food there,
getting
the refreshments and the drinks and everything.
Yeah, so we can provide everything. So 1:15 charters, what we try to do is be a one stop service. From entering Sentosa, you're taking care of all the way
until all the way here, yes. Until, you're
until after your charters, yeah, we'll yeah. send you out
that's
as
great.
Well.
That's great. Thank you, John, for taking some time out from your busy schedule to meet with us and to explain this beautiful complex. And thank you for arranging for this boat trip for us to go around Singapore Bay.
Brilliant. Yeah. Thank you very much for having us. Yeah. And I hope you guys have a good trip out at sea later on this beautiful vessel, Zensea 2. So okay. It's part of our charter company. So they've got three vessels. So if you want to know more,
I'll let you know.
But apart from that, we look forward to seeing a lot more visitors from the Philippines to come to Singapore. Come by 115 Charters. You know where to look for us.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Raul.
So we just dropped anchor here at Lazarus Island, which is about a 30-minute boat ride from the Sentosa coast. This is a perfect way to see the other outer islands in Singapore. So we chartered the boat Zensea 2, a beautiful catamaran, from 115 Charters Luxury Yachting. Very easy to get the boat for you, and they can also prepare the food, the drinks. They even have a jet ski going out there. Aside from shopping, you might as well do some cruising. As someone who understands the good things in life, a luxury watch can make anyone look sophisticated. But a custom-made watch is something entirely new and special. For anyone looking for a perfect gift to bring home, this place should be on your map. A company by the name of Cranky Cats created a watch-building workshop for a select few. Any horologist would be delighted to see how these custom watches are assembled. Now I'm going to try my skills in watchmaking. Let's see what happens. I'm here with Dominic of Cranky Cats.
Right.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for coming here.
So what is Cranky Cats all about? How did it come about?
Cranky Cats, it's like where we want to customize everything. We want to do something different from your mainstream everything else.
Yes.
So I love putting like different things, colors together. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's more like a lifestyle, a culture. The bikes are like very mainstream, you know, like you buy off the rack. It looks like you have it, I have it.
Everyone has the same thing.
So I like to inject some character to it.
Yes.
You know, so I started dolling up the bicycles.
Yeah.
And then the watch came along. Yeah. It was like the same components, you know. I work with the same thing and then there's limitless, I can just play with anyone.
Because usually everyone has the same watch, right?
Correct.
So you want it different from the rest.
Different. Even like your basic G-Shocks all the way to your expensive Swiss watch. You have it, I have it. And you know, I just want to stand up. Something different.
Different. So in the customization,
right?
What do you customize? Everything?
Everything. So you have your dials, your the movements, your face. Even the hands itself as
even
well.
Even the hands itself, right.
Even the hands.
The straps.
Straps, everything.
Yeah. So upstairs you have the workshop.
Right? Upstairs I have the workshop. Mm-hmm. Then down here is more like a lounge area. You know, so where people will come in. It's like a mini clubhouse.
Yes. Right? I even love your.
Thank you. The nice little slogan.
For ugly things,
yeah.
Right?
This one was given by my wife.
Okay.
Initially I thought it was too obnoxious.
Yes. Okay.
I was like looking. I said, "Are you sure you're putting this?" Then like, okay. Let's own it.
Okay. How did you come up with the name Cranky Cat?
Cranky Cat, so I like bicycles, so like part of it is crank. Yeah. My wife loves cats. Cranky, so it's like Cranky Cats.
How long is the workshop?
The workshop is about 4 hours.
So it takes you 4 hours to
take you about, yeah. But the main time-consuming part is actually the selection of the cards.
They take long because they don't know what
they
want.
Yeah, then they're like, they're spoiled for choice. Maybe I want to build this site, like a classic or sporty, and then you just get confused. Okay. Shall we go upstairs and start making a watch?
Okay, perfect.
Let's go.
So So I'm here with Dixon and we will go through the selection process. And this is the shopping tray. This is what we will select from that whole array of components. I have all the watch components together. Dixon helped and suggested which components I would get to match the watch that I like.
Okay, so let's begin with the workshop. Let's bring this out.
Okay, let's go.
Let's go.
Surprise, building a watch was actually easier than I thought. The process took a while, but in the end, you can be proud of yourself for making something truly special. Here it is, my Cranky Cats custom watch, made by me, of course, with the help of Dixon. Singaporean cuisine is essentially a mix of all things Asian. Some of the best restaurants here are regarded for its multifaceted flavors, from modern Singaporean cuisine to the classic Malay and Indian-inspired dishes of the region. For quite some time, Cookery Magic has offered a unique cooking workshop towards popular Singaporean dishes. This immersive experience is literally at your fingertips. So I'm with Roxana of Cookery Magic. She's very well known here in Singapore for giving cooking classes for Singaporean dishes.
Singaporean dishes, yes.
Yes. So Roxana, what are we going to cook today?
Okay, I thought I'd teach you something that's very, very popular in Singapore.
Yes.
So lontong consists of a dish that is lontong, which is the rice cake. I'm sure you have this in the Philippines.
Yes, we do have that.
Yeah, so it's like cooked for many hours and the rice is compact, you know?
Yes.
A lontong is served in a stew, which is called sayur lodeh.
Sayur lodeh.
Okay, sayur lodeh. And then you sprinkle with two condiments, which is sambal belacan tumis, which is a chili paste. Sprinkle on it, we're going to do a thing called serunding, which is a spice of coconut.
So what goes in the stew? Oh, it's a vegetable stew.
It's vegetables plus a little bit of prawns. This one here is for the sambal belacan tumis, which is a chili paste, which is like the most important thing in a Malay household. Yeah.
And tumis means fried.
Fried.
Yes.
So what we have here is we have fresh chili, dry chili, which you must soak in hot water, shallots,
garlic,
and galangal.
Galangal.
And then you have the belacan, of course.
Yes.
This is the tamarind, sour.
Yeah.
And this is gula melaka, or coconut sugar.
So this is the sweet part.
In Southeast Asian food, we like to play with five flavors.
Yes.
Hot, bitter, sweet, sour, salty.
And that's all balanced.
It's all balanced. All about how much you like, whether you like it hotter. Now, if you like it hotter, I can put in chili padi.
The bird's eye chili.
I'll add that in for you.
Okay.
What we have is in the rempah, which is the spice paste, it's just going to be a bit of shallots.
Yes.
Galangal, lemongrass. Now we're going to pound the lemongrass.
Yes,
and just a little bit. I don't want to do too much because we're just doing a little bit.
Garlic.
So all this is going to be pounded.
Yeah.
And then what we have is we have the spices.
Okay.
This is chili powder, coriander powder, turmeric powder, and cumin powder. So this equals your basic curry powder.
Yes, that's right.
Again, the sweet and sour.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the gula melaka, which is the sweet. and then the tamarind.
And the coconut?
It's just freshly grated coconut. Okay. There's not going to be any oil. Everything is going to be mixed together. We're just going to dry roast it.
Okay. Let's go to your kitchen and let's start cooking.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Roxana.
Yeah. You made this. You're the master now.
Masterpiece. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So now this can also be eaten with just regular rice. So we put a few pieces of this.
Rice, yes.
Be one tofu.
Yeah, one tofu.
We mix this up.
Yeah.
And then you just take whatever vegetables you like, and you let this swim.
Okay.
So it's like swimming in the.
In the broth.
In the broth, yes. Yeah. So it's like a soup, you know.
So I'll mix everything.
Mix everything up.
Wow.
Is it very hot? It's very hot because of this?
No, it's wow because it's good.
Oh, it's good. Okay, for me, I thought you went wow because it's too hot. Yeah. That's a lot of chili.
Okay. Thank you, Roxana, for inviting me to your home and teaching me a new recipe which I can now make.
My pleasure. Well, when you make it, make sure you send me a photograph.
Oh yeah, for sure.
So this way you have to make it.
Yeah, incredible. I love the food.
Good.
Thank you.
You're most welcome. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
If your journey leads you down to East Coast Road at Marine Parade, a particular boutique may stand out from the rest. At Ruma Kimchu, one may learn about the vibrant Peranakan culture of Singapore. The store is also known for serving a famous rice dumpling called the Nyonya Chang, which started way back in 1945.
Hello, Raymond.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Yes.
So, what is Peranakan culture?
Peranakan culture is a lifestyle culture.
Mm-hmm.
It actually referring to the foreigners like the Peranakan Chinese, the ancestors when they first came. Over the period and time, they start to adapt what is good cultures from their lifestyle and adapt into the Chinese culture.
Yes. So can you take us around and let's look at the different attributes to the Peranakan culture?
One of the most Chinese feel about Peranakan culture would be their use of the Peranakan porcelain.
Okay.
These porcelain are still all from China. The only difference is when they customize this porcelain into Southeast Asia, they actually request the porcelain to have no dragons.
Oh, no dragons?
Yes, only the phoenix.
Okay.
What happens is in Chinese culture, phoenix in pairs are usually representing the male and female entity, Feng and Huang. This is the traditional dress worn by the Nonyas. We call it the Nonya Sarong Kebaya.
Sarong
As the name implies, the kebaya will always be worn with a typical beautiful sarong. Then the top is the kebaya, which is a long sleeve blouse. The designs are all done with colorful Chinese-like embroideries.
Yes.
The beauty of the kebaya is actually the lace.
The lace.
So how we match the colors together is rather interesting. Actually, in fact, we have a very simple rule is at least one or two colors that the top blouse has and the skirt has it, you can match it.
Okay.
The lace will do the blending effect for you.
And then, of course, the shoe has to match also.
Correct.
Yeah.
These ones here are done using the Japanese glass beads. So the beads are a lot more bigger, but still it's done by hand where we stitch the beads up one by one.
So one by hand.
Mm-hmm.
Raymond, we're now in a very typical Paranacan dining room.
Yes.
And you'll be serving us Paranacan sweets and
kuey. We call it kuey.
Kuey.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have three most significant Peranakan kuehs often seen in Singapore.
Okay.
The first one is the Nonya Chang.
Chang.
Yeah. It came from the Chinese word bajang, which means meat dumplings.
So this has minced meat inside.
Diced pork.
Diced
with
pork.
Winter melon and all the spices. Give it a try.
Wow.
This one is called kueh lapis sagu, also known as the rainbow kueh locally.
Okay.
Yeah. So this one here is actually made using tapioca flour with coconut milk. And we colored it layers by layer with natural food coloring like pandan leaf to get the juice out, to get the green coloring up there.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
Yeah, you peel it by the sides.
Okay.
Eat it with small mouthful. So that's what the ladies would do, roll it nicely and then put it layer by layer in the mouth.
Very daintily. Mm-hmm. And this one?
We call this pineapple tarts. Using pineapple to make the jam is most suitable.
Yes.
And it works very well because the sour taste of the pineapples with the sugar and the spices like cinnamon, star anise, and nutmeg. Pineapple itself, in its dialect, is called ong lai, which means money coming in.
Okay.
So in Chinese New Year, it means the more pineapple tarts you eat, the more wealth coming in for the year.
Thank you very much, Raymond, for taking us around the Peranakan home, and for showing us the culture and the heritage and how it fits into Singapore society.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
The lifestyle of the Roaring Twenties must have been a time of great innovation and ideas. Like a time capsule, a visit to the Atlas Bar, one of Asia's 50 best bars, can teleport you back to an era full of class and integrity. I've been here many times and I'm so excited to share this gorgeous bar with you.
Vicky, thank you again for having us over here at the Atlas Bar. It is one of my favorite bars in the world. Why did you name the bar Atlas?
So Atlas is inspired by the building that it's in and the architecture, Art Deco architecture. We wanted to mirror the grand cafes of Europe, which are all-day dining and drinking establishments. And it's been centered on the Art Deco period.
Yes.
So we have twin pillars of our beverage program, which are gin, which is in, we have 1,400 gins.
Okay.
One of the largest collection in the world.
Yes.
And then the champagne room, which sits right under it.
Yes.
With 250 different labels of champagne.
Yeah.
And the reason those two drinks are our pillars is because during the 1920s, that's what a lot of people were drinking.
Right.
So this is our trio, our Atlas suite of our signature martinis.
Yeah.
So first is the Atlas martini, which is really our the one that everyone comes for. It's a beautiful martini with a champagne vinegar, which brings back to the two pillars. The next one is the orange blossom martini, which is made with our Atlas orange gin.
Yes.
We did a gin in collaboration with one of the best craft distillers out of the US, St. George.
Yes.
And because in the 1920s, there was a lot of recipes that had this orange gin.
Okay.
And at the time when we opened Atlas, it didn't really exist anymore.
Yeah.
So we brought it back with St. George and it features the orange blossom, so it's a really delicate, very refreshing, beautiful gin. And the last is one of my favorites, which is the espresso martini.
Okay.
So that's actually vodka based, but it has a really creamy, luscious texture and perfect for a mid-afternoon.
You know, we'll start with the Atlas martini.
Okay.
Strong.
Yes.
It is strong.
It's a great way to start the night.
Yes. Right. With a bang.
Yes, exactly.
And then now we go to the orange blossom martini.
Yes.
Oh, this is very smooth.
Yes, very
smooth. Yes. And of course the espresso martini.
The perfect pick-me-up.
Yeah. especially if you had a long night.
Exactly.
Yeah, I love the foam on top,
yes,
and the taste of coffee in,
yes,
it. Yes.
The espresso martini is having a bit of a moment at the moment.
Yes.
Yeah, everyone's doing them, but I feel like we do the
do
best.
The best, of course. You always have to do the best.
Of course,
best.
I'm biased, but yes. I've tried quite a few, and yeah, I do think that we do
the them. Best. And so this is the, you said this
so this base. One is the Sunset Hill.
Yes.
And it comes from the Belgian chapter in, yes, our latest cocktail menu, mm-hmm, and it's designed to look like a Belgian beer with,
yeah,
the waffle.
With the waffle on, yeah, top, yeah. It's very good. Cheers.
Cheers.
Yes.
And then a little bite
of, yeah, the waffle.
Exactly.
I noticed that the Singaporeans call this place Gotham.
Yes.
Yes. All we need now is Batman to come out.
Yes.
It's such an incredible bar, and I love the way you've pushed it even further.
Oh, thank, yeah, you. Yeah. It's been a real journey, love story for, yeah, me, yes, as well, because the building is so beautiful, mm-hmm, and I never had a chance to work with my grandfather. Yeah. I came in after him, yeah, and the space was always so beautiful. Yeah. We really just gave it the love and, mm-hmm, the attention and the offering, yeah, that it deserved.
So Vicky, thank you so much for taking time out from your busy schedule to have us over here at the Atlas Bar.
It was such a pleasure, yeah, having you. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, and I'll be back.
Please do.
Yeah, I will. Thank you.
Thank you.
Establishment in 2004, the Imperial Treasure Group has become synonymous with fine dining, authentic Chinese cuisine. Today, I'm going to dine here at the Imperial Treasure Super Peking Duck. As the name of the restaurant suggests, the resto is well known for roasting the Peking duck to perfection. In more recent years, the restaurant has been studded with awards, including Asia's 50 Best Restaurants, as well as 2 Michelin stars by the Michelin Guide. This is where Chinese luxury cuisine resides. I'm here in one of my favorite restaurants in Singapore. It's called Imperial Treasure Super Peking Duck. And I'm with Lester, the COO of the Imperial Treasures Group. Thank you for having us here, Lester.
Thank you, Raul, yeah, for choosing us.
Yes. Why did the restaurant concentrate on Peking duck?
In the year 2009,
yes,
before the Paragon outlet, yes, started this Peking duck, mm-hmm, concept restaurant, okay, in Singapore, yeah, Singapore don't have a proper Peking duck concept. So our team, mm-hmm, actually worked very hard, mm-hmm, travel to Beijing, very several trips,
okay,
to test it, to train, to try all different famous Peking duck from there.
Yes.
And they all come up to a fine tone taste, mm, and the recipe to pair with Singapore taste.
Yes.
So we decided we want to come out our iconic Super Peking duck concept,
yeah,
Sean.
Yeah.
This outlet, the mainstream of the menu, yeah, is Cantonese cuisine menu.
Okay.
As additional, yeah, we put in the Super Peking duck,
oh,
as one,
okay,
of the main item, yeah, in our menu.
Your restaurants have Michelin stars, right?
Yes, yes. 2 Michelin stars, mm-hmm, for our Shanghai outlet, and also 2 Michelin stars, yeah, for Guangzhou Cantonese outlet. And the another Guangzhou different concept outlet, yeah, also won 1 Michelin star.
Okay.
And 1 Michelin star for Hong Kong, mm-hmm, and 1 Michelin star for Teochew,
yeah,
in Singapore.
Okay. In Singapore. So the group has 7 Michelin stars altogether.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm excited to try the Peking duck.
We always offer this part of the duck.
The back.
because this actually is the most crispiest part of the skin of the duck. With a little drip, sugar. Yeah.
It's a little sweet, huh?
Yeah.
It's a little sweet.
And yet not that sweet.
No.
We always also stand by our homemade pancake.
Homemade, that's homemade.
Homemade, yeah. Homemade.
Lester, we had the first way. What is the second way a duck is eaten?
We always get the approval from the diners when we place the order of the duck.
Okay.
Always ask them, how would you like the remaining of the duck, meat and bone, to be cooked?
Okay.
We always give the choices.
Yes.
We always suggest you can either cook with noodle,
okay,
or do with fried rice,
yeah,
or you can do the minced duckling. Come along with the lettuce,
yeah, with the lettuce
wrap. This is one of our another specialty, a braised thick noodle.
Okay.
Where in Singapore, I think it's more commonly named as mee pok noodle. Mee pok. Would you like to give a try?
Yeah, let's give it a try.
Yeah, thank you. When it comes to this Singapore chili crab, we always serve along some mantou.
This is fantastic. So Lester, I am full with the delicious food that you've served me, the Peking duck, the crab, the noodles.
Yeah.
I can leave with a big smile, okay? Thank you so much for having us in Imperial Treasure Super Peking Duck.
Singapore's nightlife has always been filled with spontaneity and excitement. Anywhere you turn, parties are constantly happening. Today, we visit Level 33. This award-winning dining concept is situated on the rooftop of the Marina Bay Financial Center. Not only is the view spectacular, but this bar is also popularly known as the world's highest urban microbrewery.
Martin, thank you for having us here.
Yeah, thanks for coming, Raul.
What made you decide to build the world's highest urban microbrewery?
I mean, the microbrewery, that it became the world's highest,
yes,
is then a coincidence.
Yes.
I was looking for a very special, unique location.
Yes.
So I love my good beers, but I also love good wines and good food. And hardly you have everything combined in one concept, right? So you have microbreweries, which focus then on pub grub, on easy food, maybe with bands or sports screening. And I didn't want that part.
Yes,
I wanted just the good beers.
Yeah.
And then maybe after two good beers, you want to sit down for a nice food with a nice bottle of wine.
Yes.
So that concept didn't exist.
Yes.
So that's why I looked for a unique location for this kind of concept.
Yes.
And when I walked around with a real estate broker and we saw models of this beautiful building, we saw the models, and I immediately looked at the penthouse and said,
I want that.
What do you plan for that one?
Okay.
And they say, we want a very unique, outstanding concept, one of a kind. And I said, I think I can help you there.
Yeah, okay.
And besides, obviously, I thought putting a microbrewery on a development with 20,000 bankers cannot be a bad idea.
Yes,
so so far, it worked out well, yeah.
So, Martin, how did you bring up the brewery?
And that was the biggest challenge.
Okay.
To begin with, when I signed the lease, I didn't know how we bring them up, but then we found a way. We built a mobile crane where the bar is now positioned. We had to take out, I think, 9 of these glass panels of the facade.
Yeah.
And then with the crane, we lifted all the tanks and especially the ice machine up from the sidewalk.
Yes.
Up here, all 156 meters high.
Uh-huh.
So you have to bring the tanks up and they already have to be in the right sequence.
Yeah.
How to bring them in then for the setting up of the brewery.
Yes. So Martin, you serve beer. What is your best seller?
So the most popular beer is always the lager.
The lager.
The lager, yeah. Now we have a big variety of events because also our concept was set up that you can have a casual event on the terrace. You can take your wedding picture here when you have your solemnization here. Private dining room, which we have a cooperation with Baron de Rothschild.
Yes. So congratulations on your 12th year.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us here. Your beer is excellent.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Cheers.
So what is Level 33's cuisine? What are you guys known for?
Well, I would say our cuisine is more towards modern European / Australian. Mm-hmm. But the unique thing is that we try to incorporate beer and the beer brewing elements throughout our menu. Okay, so today, this is the Wagyu tri-tip from West Home, Australia. Mm-hmm. So it's dry aged for 14 days in spent grain and koji. We age ourselves in our dry ager. This would be the local sea bass with pearl barley risotto. This is farmed locally here in Singapore, so to go into our sustainability push.
Yeah. Okay.
This is salad of stracciatella cheese and tomatoes.
I love stracciatella cheese.
The beer element there is the crispy beer malt.
Cheers, Jake. Thank you for the wonderful food. Goes perfect with the beer.
Thank you for coming in.
Perfect combination. Beer, beef, fish, and salad. I truly enjoyed my escapade so far here in Singapore. For me, luxury is having time for yourself and appreciating new experiences. Singapore has truly been a luxurious escape. Thanks for joining me on this episode. This is Raul Manzano, EIC on the Move.